What's going on, everybody? Since the Bleach Thousand Year Blood War episode 7 had dropped, along with weekly Shounen Jump magazine, give us a beautiful illustration, as you can see from the thumbnail and from on your screen right now, Captain Ruruka. We've had many questions in regards to names and the squads that they're in and who they are, etc., and what they do. And I can at least give you some of the information you are dying to know, more so on the squads and the names of these characters. And everything else is kind of, well, let's just say it's like looking into an empty cookie jar, seeing the crumbs and then trying to find out what cookie it is. However, there is going to be some interesting things we're going to be speaking about along the way. So if you are interested in these characters, a little bit about their potential backgrounds and their character names, etc., then please stick around and enjoy the video. Now, as far as this video goes, it has really tested some of the limits of where my Bleach knowledge has gone on through the manga, through the anime, even light novel stuff to some certain extent, and overall just general knowledge as it goes. So I'm going to try my best to try and explain everything as much as I can, because as these captains stand, and as we know, these are captains that fought with Mr. Yuha Bar in the Thousand Year Blood War against the Shinigami versus the Quincy's. And we know this because we actually see it within episode 7, as we know. These are in fact the original Gotei 13. This is a confirmation to all of us that this is the original squad, or squads. But we also know that these guys actually existed as well a thousand years prior, towards that 2000 years ago, with Chojuro versus Yamamoto. Now, the reason why I'm talking about all this is because our first captain on our list is Genryu Sai Yamamoto Shikikuni, which you all are fully aware of who he is. But it's important to get the backstory on this, because we're going to be talking about a little bit of theories here and there. And as we know, the Gotei 13 actually follows underneath Central 46. So during the time of 1,000 years ago, even to 2,000 years ago, we know that in fact Central 46 did actually coexist. And it's important to note this as well, because many people were asking, well, where's Kurinji Tanjiro, or the other one from the Squad Zero members, where is Senjimaru? Because we all know from these captains that they all have Shihakshos, which are things that Senjimaru actually created. So where are they, and why are they not a part of the original Gotei 13? Well, as I said, we're going to get onto that. Even though someone like Kisuke can, you know, invent something such as the Hogyoku or something like a portable Gigai, it doesn't mean you have to be a captain to invent something to go to Squad Zero. So it could be a fact that any of these could be actually just normal squad members, or even lieutenants for that matter. We don't really fully know, but I have some theories more so on the Unohana side of things. So Genryu Sai Yamamoto being our number one, obviously he's been there from the very beginning. X, Y, and Z, you don't really know about Genryu Sai all too much. Now, in terms of episode 7's ending song, all of these characters are not in order of their squad. Well, I say that as partly true, because all of them were, except for the first two, which could have been an animation error, could have been a storyboarding error, we don't really know. But yes, 2 and 3 were actually misplaced. Yes, the one that you think is a Shihoin is in fact a Shihoin. And the name of this character is called Shihoin Chika. So the first name being Chika and the last name being Shihoin. Now, at first I thought Chika was a girl's name, but after looking at the episode again, it seems that the person has pecs, so I'm going to personally assume it is a guy. However, I can see, you know, why people would say it looks like a female. But, you know, Chika is in fact a male and is a very tall boy that was in the episode kicking off heads, and yes, is the first captain of the Shihoin royal family. Now, are we going to be seeing a trend of royal family members within the original Gotei 13? It's up for debate. But yes, as you can see on screen, it is Shihoin Chika. There's the kanji. Enjoy, take that as you will. Some of these characters will also have a little bit of meaning towards them as well. And because this is something like 1,000 to even 2,000 years ago that these captains existed, we're looking at very old Edo period type of kanji, where some of the names that are given to Japanese people back then would correlate to some sentences. So a lot of their names did have a literal meaning to some certain extent. And we'll get onto some of those characters, because there are two characters that kind of give us maybe a little bit of an inkling in regards to what they do or their abilities or maybe backstory. Now again, sorry if I butcher these names, but let's get onto the rest of them, shall we? In Squad 3, we have Kinroku Izuhara. And you can see him on screen, there's really not really much for me to say in regards to this character. He looks very bog standard and nothing too special, though I will say I did like his art of killing within the episode, going for neck slices. Looks kind of like a stealthy kind of dude, but other than that, I've not really gotten any opinions on him whatsoever, and his name doesn't really indicate anything to me or stand out to me as anyone that's particularly interesting. So unfortunately, I'm gonna have to show a little bit of less love for this captain. In terms of our fourth seat, the one character character that I thought was originally a girl, because freckles on an anime character usually indicate that it's a female, as well as long hair. Looks like to me, again in the episode that we saw, that it is in fact a male. And the fourth seat's name is Chikiri Shijima. And again, it will be on screen, because I'm going to butcher these. So yes, Chikiri is in fact the captain of the fourth seat. Now, I believe at this point it wasn't really the healing corpse as we know of, and I'll explain that explanation a little bit later on when we get to Unohana. Now, the one thing I did notice about this captain in general, which I did find was a nice touch to Chikiri, was the fact that they killed all of their enemies with a decapitation, which I thought was an interesting way of killing your enemies. Now, again, going from the ending visuals and from the image that we got here, again, there's not really much to go on. I did enjoy the fighting style of this character, but again, looks menacing enough, can't wait to see more of, but nothing that really alludes to me a type of purpose in terms of how we know the Gotei 13 as it stands. Next one is an interesting one, because a lot of people made some Ishin or Shiba type references. So you'd be interested to know that the captain of the 5th division is Danjiro Obana. That is Danjiro Obana. Now, interestingly enough, this does look like a Shiba, as we all know Shibas to look, I suppose, in a way, when it comes to, you know, Ganju or Ishin. It has that type of characteristic, and I think that's done on purpose to some degree. Now, another interesting thing with this character is more so because all of these captains are in Shikai, by the looks of things, it seems that the hilt of his Zanpakuto in general seems to have a little fiery flame on the hilt, and that fiery flame is in reminiscence a little bit to Kaku Shiba's emblem. What is that called? I'll just say her clothing. You see it on screen anyway. So does that have any connection? Is that a reach? As I said, the majority of this video is going to be a reach, because you never really know and you're taking everything or every piece of information that you can. But again, there's a purpose to draw that on the hilt, and there's a purpose for Kaku Shiba's emblem thing on her clothes. So I don't see why not. If I'm wrong, I'm wrong. Who's going to blame me, right? But it's interesting because the name doesn't add up. It's not a Shiba name. It is Danjiro Obana. Obana is the last name. And it really kind of brought me back a little bit towards, you know, Kyoraku's brother who married a Issei family member, which was Nanao's mother. But of course, any male that marries into that household seems to die because of a curse, lol. But we also know as well that many of you made the reference to one of the other characters in here, whether it's going to be Issei family bloodline character, which again, if you remember, Issei clan members don't actually have their own Zanpakuto. So I'm not so much on the same field as you guys in some of that, but I do believe Obana Danjiro, it's quite plausible that maybe this person married into another royal family, and then, you know, this guy could have actually married a Shiba for all we know. And, you know, he kept the woman's name because of royalty. That's also a possibility. But then again, would a royal family really date a commoner or marry a commoner? Again, these are questions that we don't have answers to. But again, there's your name. Go with what you will. There's the emblem that you see on Kukaku Shiba's clothing. Take that with what you will and make your fan-cracked theories, because honestly, I'm out of them. But regardless of what, the design is cool as fuck. So, I appreciate it. Ah, I wanted to save this best for last, but yes, yes, the queen of the 6th captain division is, what's her name? What is her name? I already have a pet name for her. The pink haired girl that looks like Maruka, Captain Maruka, that most of you are all very interested in, is Furufushi Saito, or how I would like to call her by her new nickname, Fushi. Fushi-chan or Furu-chan? I don't know, but it's Furufushi. You know, I might be saying that completely wrong, but Furufushi Saito is her name. I'm not opposed to it. You know, it works, I think. But yes, she is the head of the 6th division. Now, of course, I have some interesting one with this name, because this name actually has a sentence in it. And as I said, most, you know, Japanese people in the Edo period or even older than that have, you know, literal sentences as their name. So it was interesting to know that Furufushi means in Japanese perpetual youth or immortality. So time to get some crack theories on the go and say, if that is the case, if Furufushi is in fact a derivative of that perpetual youth or immortality, let's just throw in some theories out there. One, what does immortality mean? Can she continuously stay that age? Can she, you know, is she like on that Tsunade from now Naruto type thing? Is she in hell? Probably not. Is she still alive? Again, very plausible. Is Raruka a descendant from her? Again, very plausible. But, you know, I think it would be very interesting for her to be immortal. And I think that that could really throw some spanners in the works, especially for the Gotei 13 going forward, in regards to if we get the Hell chapters on later on down the road, whether she'd be like a captain that we just don't see because, hey, maybe she didn't go to Hell, maybe she's still alive. And that would really turn some heads and maybe get us a lot more lore in the future. So Kubo's could potentially really set up some really great things in regards to immortality, or I guess forever youthfulness. So yes, sixth captain Furufushi Saito. I'm gonna have to get used to that. However, people are asking if she's like a royalty. Is she part of the Byakuya Kuchiki clan or the Kuchiki clan? And I had to really go back on this one. There's not really any type of squad in general, and this goes for the same as the Shihoin clan. And why I found it a bit interesting in regards to Central 46 and how long Central 46 has kind of, I guess, existed within the Soul Society when they formed. You know, was it something that Yamamoto formed himself? You know, if there's something in the light novels, do tell in the comment section down below, because again, there's a lot of stuff that I can't really cite off the top of my head when it comes to novel stuff. You know, I have very basic knowledge. However, you know, it would make sense that, for example, a Shihoin who was, you know, a OG or someone that was there before the Soul Society formed per se, that they were there as well as one of the people that made the rules for Central 46 to follow and govern. However, it would also strike me as weird for royals to be captains that would work under Central 46 as well. It doesn't seem like royals would kind of do that either. In regards to the Shihoin family clan, I do feel like it is a title that will be passed down in that regard. However, for the rest of the captains, maybe not so much, because, you know, in regards to the 6C or the Kuchiki clan per se, there's nothing here that kind of shouts out to me that it is a title of 6C that has to go to a royal family member. It's free to everyone. And the reason why I say this in regards to Furufushi is because, one, she doesn't have any of the, as far as we know, in terms of the clan's traditions, in terms of like their hair pieces or the scarf, for example, she doesn't really have any of these concepts built into her character in terms of appearance, nor in her actions either. Sure, she has like an eye patch, and sure, she has like this headband type thing, but when it comes to looking at like the names of these accessories from the Kuchiki household, there's no correlation that I can find at the moment. And maybe it's something that started from her, we don't know. But considering her name and considering the accessories that she wears, there's no evidence for me to kind of justify telling you that she's of royalty or if she's a descendant of the Kuchiki household in general. It seems to me that she's not royalty, boys, but she could be as well. So again, you feel free to feel how you want to feel in regards to this. But yes, the immortality thing sounds like it kind of goes hard. Then we have our seventh captain of the Gotei 13, which is going to be Nobusuna Shigio. And the name almost reads like a sentence, which means something along the lines of the one who executes the threads of military force. Just a little note that was written down. But yes, that's what that means. I don't really what that means in terms of one who executes the threads of military force. However, he does look like an assassin, so I'm going to make it fit. One on one makes two. It is now what it is. But yes, he looks like an assassin. I love his design. He was one of the characters that was front and center within the color page set we got. I feel like he is important. I did find it funny that Furufushi and Nobusuna both have meanings to their names in concept. So it's possible that we may get some more information regarding them in the future. That's fingers crossed. So in regards to the 7th Division, yeah, that's pretty much all I have to say on that. Maybe it was an assassination clan at the time. We have number 8, which is everybody's favorite braided girl hair, big bazunga dunga Issei looking clan member girl that everybody likes. Even though Furufushi's way better. Her name, which I'm pretty sure a lot of you are like, tell me the name. It's actually quite of a weird one, I think. Unsai Katori Batsu. As I said, I don't think she is an Issei clan member because she does have a Zanpakuto toe. It's a polar arm. Someone did say because it looked like Hazuki Maru. Is it a reincarnation of that? No, Zanpakuto toes cannot be with different people. They can't be resurrected. All Zanpakuto toes are completely different. This was also set by a Q&A in Club Outside as well, which was a Tite Kubo exclusive. Zanpakuto toes are all unique and all new and don't go to different people. So in regards to that, I don't think she's an Issei clan member or a relative in any way, shape, or form, and she has her own Zanpakuto to kind of prove that. unless it is made as a weapon purely for the Issei clan and isn't an individual weapon, which I highly doubt, because again, there's no evidence to suggest it. But it is interesting, because I guess when it comes to these type of characters, we kind of just expect them to be healers. Yeah, not the case from what we saw within the episode 7. She just completely cut a dude in half. So cute but deadly. So if you wish to take your chances, then my hat's off to you. But I'll go with my psycho twin tails, thank you very much. Number 9, our scientist guy is called Entetsu Kamoi. And yeah, there's not really much to say about this character. His sword is very blunt, so it's more like a baton. If anything, it looks like I guess you could say it looks like a spine. But in regards to his grills, I don't think those are his teeth, because in both the illustration that Kubo gave us and in the anime, you do see a line where the mouth is, but each of those drawings look like his mouth is closed and the teeth are like popping out, or they're painted on top. So I originally thought they were like a tattoo, but when I saw in the anime, it looked like they were coming out of his mouth, like you were holding like a mouthpiece or a guard, a gum guard or something like that. So I do think it's an accessory, but again, you can discuss that in the comment section down below of what you generally think of that. Interesting character. I expected him to be more so on the research side and development side of the squad. But again, these concepts didn't even exist until like Kisuke and Mayuri came into the picture. So again, dude's just slightly psycho. But yeah, again, I love this design nonetheless. He's one of my friends' favorite characters already. So, I mean, hey, some people love it. I think it's raw. I'm very interested. If he came on screen again, I wouldn't say no. For our 10th captain, we have Furuoki Otokawa. That's Furuoki Otokawa. Furuoki Otokawa. Yeah, I keep having to say that because I sometimes fumble a little bit with these names, but yeah, Furuoki Otokawa. That's how I'm just gonna stick with that. Yeah, in regards to like his only appearance being the straw hat, unfortunately we didn't get to see more in the ending of the episode 7, because in the original drawing that we got, we at least get to see a hand that's like grabbing on the shaft of his sword, or sorry, the hilt or the handle of his sword. But we didn't really get that within the ending of the episode. It was a completely different drawing, or that with the hand being moved out of the way. And it's unfortunate, because I would have liked to have seen a little bit more. We've kind of just got like a bog standard image, and that's unfortunate, because I would love to see at least the full body design in regards to that. I mean, look, the straw hat, he's wearing the straw hat, whether it has any semblance, again, we don't know. But I guess it is very fitting for, again, an Edo-ish kind of era of maybe the Soul Society. So when I say Edo-ish period as well, I'm kind of going on a whim and guessing in terms of like how Kubo's may be thinking. So like, take that as face value and not as fact. Number 11, as we all know, you know, Yatru Unohana, or Retsu Unohana. This is an interesting one, because we all know who Retsu Unohana is. We all know who Gemaru Yusai Yamamoto is. There's really not much to say on her as far as things that you don't already know. However, I would like to be interested in talking about the timeline, because we did talk about Tanjiro Kurinji, and we talked about Senjimaru and where they were in terms of where are they within this lineup of captains. And I found it interesting, because I did think of a little possibility of where the healing division came from, or what Unohana came to be. In terms of what we know about Kurinji, we know that he is the person that taught Unohana how to heal. We know that as a fact. We also know that roughly after the fight with Kenpachi, given that may have been like 100, 200 years ago, we don't really know the specific time frame. We know that after she fought with him, she got bored, she felt lonely, and she kind of relinquished her role as the 11th captain and went to be captain of squad 4 and kind of bring up healing. It's interesting to me because, again, Unohana is one of the longest serving captains, as said by Ukitake and also Kyoraku, along with Yamamoto. And entertain me here for a second, because it is a little bit of a theory. I would imagine throughout all these times, from 2000 years to 1000 years ago, that captains are naturally going to come and go. And out of all these captains that have come and go, I've all known Unohana. Squad Zero know Unohana. Kurinji knows Unohana. My prediction in all of this is that it's quite possible that Kurinji may have been under Unohana at one point, or maybe just a part of the divisions, learn how to heal as well. Well, we know he learned how to heal, but how to create the healing spa or the blood spa, and that's why he went to Squad Zero. You don't have to be, I don't believe, to be a captain per se, to go to squad zero. I think it certainly helps, but I think by that time that he learned how to do healing, or, you know, as he got up in the ranks, I do believe he was probably one of the original fourth member captains. And then the moment he got offered to go to squad zero, I do believe that Unohana did then step down and then go towards squad four. I do find Kurinji's and Unohana's relationship pretty interesting, and I hope we get that in episode 8. I know I'll be dating the video by saying that, but I do think that's why she went to squad 4, because I do feel after she lost the compatriots, she kind of lost a little bit of purpose, and thus, you know, once the position for squad 4 was open, she did then go and take it. And the only way I could see that position opening up is if one of the captains had died, or if someone like Kurinji had been promoted to go to squad 0. It's either one of those two factors, and I doubt Kurinji would really be offered a place in squad 4 if he was just a lieutenant. So that's kind of my prediction. And he was the one that taught Unohana how to heal too, so he was definitely like on a captain level to some sort of imagination. But I think I've spoken a little bit too much on Kurinji and Unohana. Let's get on to our 12th captain with the red face paint on his face, that, you know, is a wannabe Mayuri, or I guess Mayuri is a wannabe him. His name is as follows: Jiuhin Zenjo. Again, nothing to say on this captain in general. He's a big guy, he's got face paint, nothing that signifies to me for royalty or anything in regards to that. I mean, yeah, he has clothing under the Shihakusho, but nothing where I can pinpoint personally of anything distinguishable in regards to the Bleach verse. I mean, sure, he could be royalty for all we know, or he could be, you know, someone who serves under royalty. That's a possibility as well. But in regards to that, I have nothing to go on this man at all. Cool though, I think his appearance in episode 7, where he just grabs people and just smashes their heads together, is definitely a brawler. He's definitely a bit on the tapped in the head spectrum, but other than that, yeah, fun guy. Looks like a person that can pull up, and also, might I add, he's absolutely massive. Definitely at least 10 foot, surely, because he's towering over that, you know, I gotta get used to a name. He's towering over Fushi. And then last but not least, our creepy old guy of squad 13, it is Saizo Sakahone. Yeah, again, nothing much to say about this character as a whole. I think his brief appearance in episode 7 was interesting. It seems to me that he kind of like creeps around and probably like finishes off enemies, you know, in a not so pleasant way. Not to say he can't fight, but considering, you know, how he looks and his age, it seems to me that he just goes around, maybe assassinates a little bit, maybe finishes off a kill for anyone that's trying to survive, maybe. His end credits screen was very interesting, on like balancing on one foot. Definitely gives off that creep meter. Someone I definitely, even though he looks like he would break if I jawed him, definitely wouldn't want to mess with him at all. But squad 13 definitely seemed to have a reputation for being not so great in the health department by the looks of things. So yeah, I'm gonna leave it off with there. I've done a little bit of rambling. Those are the names. I hope you've enjoyed seeing these names. If you want to know where these are from an early issue of Weekly Shonen Jump that you'll probably be seeing in a few days. So I hope you enjoy. Hopefully we get a lot more. There seems to be a lot of demand for them, so fingers crossed that Kubo listens to our demands, Shueisha hears our demands, and hopefully we get to see more of these, especially in the Hell arc, maybe, hopefully. With that being said, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. Been handsome, and as always, people, peace out.